before I ever contemplated moving to Fort Worth, I happened to be talking to an Episcopalian architect friend of mine who lives in El Campo, which is south of here on the coast, and it's in Horton County. We were talking about the famous sheriff there, whose name was Buckshot Lane. And then he sent me, my friend, his name is Logic, which is an interesting name, Logic sent me a book about sheriffs. It's called The Texas Sheriff, Lord of the County Line. In that book, I came across a brief description of what the sheriff of this county, of Wichita County, was up against during the days of the period of, we call the Prohibition. This was an insight into this place, into this area for me. In Wichita County, I quote, officers discovered a still hidden under counters at the back of a popular cafe in the community of Bradley's Corner, Wichita County, close quote. Well, maybe the folks out there took the law into their own hands and quenched their thirst. So that was my second insight into this area. But my first impression of this area came back in 1962 when I had a blind date with a 1960 graduate of Wichita Falls High School, a then student at the University of Texas, who happens to still be my present wife. She didn't give me a bad impression of Wichita Falls. Well, now having wasted a couple of minutes of sermon time, we're here tonight to celebrate a new ministry of the Episcopal Church of Wichita Falls, a glorious night for you all and for the Diocese of Fort Worth. Before I go any further, I must pause and offer my thanks and deep gratitude to those clergy who have served this Episcopal community since we experienced the sad division and folks leaving our beloved Episcopal Church. John Payne, who stepped out of retirement to again serve in this community where he had served so faithfully, and to the regular group affectionately known as the Circuit Riders, who came from afar to serve. Steve Charlton, who is not with us tonight, Bruce Coggin, Bishop Sam Halsey, Mo Lewis, Bill Nix, Mike McEwen, Galen Poole, I said Bill Nix, and Cortland Moore, and there are others that I'm sure that I've forgotten. So bless you, ladies and gentlemen, for giving your time, your service, and sharing with us here in this place your love of the Lord. We would not be here tonight at this point in our history had it not been for your loving and your caring presence. Tonight I have some words for Mother Amy, and alas, I have some words for the good folks here in Wichita Falls who have come together under one roof to be a part of the Episcopal Church of Wichita Falls. So I guess I either have two sermons or four sermons or maybe 2 points. However, y'all came and y'all will be here for a while. We have a lot to say. As we think about tonight and what we are embarking on together, priest and congregation, let me share with you some thoughts which are more like reminders than new insights. I call the first one the source, the strength. I begin with that which is most critical to our calling as priests, as ordained clergy, and as lay ministers, lay people who are disciples. Let me quote from Henry Nouwen in The Way of the Heart, written in 1981. What does all of this mean for us in our daily life, even when we are not called to be called to the monastic life or do not have the physical constitution to survive the rigors of the desert? We are still responsible for our own solitude. Precisely because our secular milieu offers us so few spiritual disciplines, we have to develop our own. We have indeed to fashion our own desert where we can withdraw every day, shake off our compulsions, and dwell in the gentle healing presence of our Lord. Without such a desert, we will lose our own soul while preaching the good news to others. But with such a spiritual abode, we will become increasingly conformed to Him in whose name we minister. The very first thing we need to do is to set apart a time and a place to be with God and with Him alone. It is a concrete and specific as daily life itself. When I visited Mother Teresa in Calcutta a few years ago and asked her how to live out my vocation as a priest, she simply said, "Spend 1 hour a day in adoration of your Lord and never do anything you know is wrong, and you will be all right." Close quote from Mother Teresa. Continuing now the quote from Henry Nouwen, she might have said something else to a married person with children and something else again to someone who lives in a larger community, but like all great disciples of Jesus, Mother Teresa affirmed again the truth that ministry can be fruitful only if it grows out of a direct and intimate encounter with our Lord. Close quote. Lay and clergy must discipline ourselves. Carve out time. Find a place, a physical place, that is our place of solitude. I have to confess that I find this is one of the most difficult things that I do as a priest and as a bishop. It seems there are too many more important things to do than sit around and pray and meditate. In reality, I know that this is essential to my soul's health and that of my flock. And I'm reminded so often that Jesus even took time away to be by himself, more times than we even know. Secondly, hear the word of the collect again. She may love and care for your people, and that together we follow Jesus Christ, offering to you their gifts and talents. This prayer frames a good bit of our ministry as a priest tending the flock. From that, I would like to say, know your people. Know where they live. And just as important, know where they work. I realize that this may sound impractical and certainly old-fashioned to some younger clergy, but visit them in their home and visit them at a person's workplace if it's practical. I discovered in my 32 years as a parish priest that parishioners loved having their pastor come to visit them at their home or even at their work, even when I felt like it was maybe imposing on them. A story. I had a senior warden when I first became the rector of this parish, and it came to my attention this one day that we had a crucial decision to make about the parish, but it had to be made that day. And we had to do it right then. That's what I felt that the Lord was saying. And it may have been the bank also. I think it was the bank. He happened to be a rancher. He lived out in the country. So when I arrived at the ranch at his house, I was told that he was obviously not there. He was out working calves at the pen. So I finally meandered around and found him with two other men working cattle. All they were doing was branding and they were dipping, they were giving them medicine, and they were clipping horns. And they would put the calves in the chute, you know, then it, you know, closes up and holds them while they do all this. But I noticed while I was watching him and talking to my senior warden, who was paying pretty good attention to me, that the calves' heads were moving around. But then there was this arm, and I went over and grabbed it, and I just went like that and held the head of the calf still so they could clip the horns. So I stood there, and I was talking to Joe, and I kept talking every once in a while. Some of you all who've seen this or done this know he hit a vein. And that blood just went kind of like that. And I was sitting there like this. So I had these streaks of blood, you know, on my white collar. Well, we got through that, as it turned out. I think that was a very important pastoral visit for me and for Joe. And incidentally, I was careful the next time I visited him at the ranch to be sure that he wasn't working cattle. Remember, he was doing something else. You're there for the people in your congregation, wherever and whenever. You and I are called to be with our people at rehearsal dinners, at quinceañeros, at banquets, at anniversaries. We're called to share in the joys and the fun of our flock. And we are called to be with our folks in sad, tragic, traumatic moments in their lives. Almost always, we have no great words or phrases to pass on to them. We only have ourselves and God's love to share. Amy, in your ministry, you know what I'm talking about because you've been there with heartbroken people. If there are any words to be spoken, God will give you those words. Remembering Joshua's wonderful words, "For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." Bishops sometimes hear from parishioners through letters, emails, calls, or conversations at parish meetings. And it goes something like this: "Could you get our priest to visit parishioners when they're ill or when they're in the hospital? Or could you teach our minister to go to meetings that she or he is supposed to attend?" Now that sounds a little silly for some of us because we don't know any clergy like that, but I do. My point, and I've said this for years, show up. Show up. Show up when you're supposed to. Show up to church on time. Show up to meetings when you're supposed to be there. Show up when you're not expected. Show up when it's not convenient. And show up when it interferes with my schedule or my family's schedule. How many of the clergy here, the more mature clergy, let me say it that way, they know who they are, who have spent maybe a Christmas Eve or a Christmas morning at the hospital with someone and not their family? Show up. In my early ministry, there was a story that I still remember about visiting this particular person in the hospital, and I would go about, you know, every other day, and And she was in the hospital for maybe 3 weeks, back in the days when you could stay in the hospital for 3 weeks. And insurance companies didn't care about that, I guess. And she got out and she got well, and I heard the story in a roundabout way that she started telling her friends that her pastor was there every day to see her. Every day, 7 days a week. Well, she remembered my presence. She remembered, I hope, that God's love and God's care was there every day or every other day in truth to share with her for her healing and her encouragement. I recently ran into a parishioner in one of our congregations in the diocese who was very anxious to tell me when her new rector arrived a while back. On the very first day of work, she asked for a list of the shut-ins. The first thing she did was ask for a list of the shut-ins, an expression of Christ's love to those who are not able to get out very well. Well, as our collect tells us, with patience and understanding, she may love and care for your people. When you were a deacon, and those of us who are priests and bishops were a deacon once before, we are always a deacon in heart and in mind and spirit. And we have a role. Your role was and is today to hold up the needs and the hopes of the poor, the marginalized, and those who are forgotten. You are to speak out, as Jesus did, about the needs of those that you encounter. You are called to be their voice when they have no voice. Speak out when there is injustice or wrong or those things contrary to God's law of love. And now to the congregation. When I was called to be rector at the young age of 28 in Victoria, there was such relief on the part of the vestry and the congregation. They finally had a rector to do the work and ministry they had been doing for months, and they didn't have to do that anymore, and they were thinking, oh, thank you, Jesus, we finally got someone to work. They could relax and take it easy. And, you know, in that case, 40 years ago, they did. But as we know, and as you all know so well, that's not the case here. It's a temptation, though. It's a very real temptation. You all are a team working together to build up the kingdom of God in this place called Wichita Falls. Our epistle reading reminds us of this in the phrase, when each part is working properly. And as you all begin your ministry together in this place, remember, as St. Luke tells us in our gospel reading, we're called to be a part of the harvest, the building up of God's kingdom in this part of God's creation. And as we respond to this call to serve Christ and Christ's people here, we must remember a fact of life, a hard fact of life. The longer Mother Amy is your priest, there's a very real possibility the more she will disappoint you. And the longer you, as a congregation, serve Christ with and serve his people with Mother Amy, the more you will disappoint her. Like any human relationship based on the love of Christ that we were taught, we have to forgive each other. When we fail each other, we have to forgive each other. When we fall short, we have to forgive each other. And keep on trying. Trying to do what God is calling us to do in our ministry together. You will remember at the beginning of our service this evening, Mother Amy made a commitment to you and to God to carry out the trust and responsibilities of her new calling as priest here. And you all promised to God, to your bishop, and to each other to support and uphold her in this new beginning. So in reality, we're all in this together. We're all in this together. Congregation, priest, bishop, friends. Another word to the congregation. I didn't have to look it up. It's called indispensable. Another story at one parish that I inherited an altar guild rectress who had held that position since the church had been formed, which was for at least 11 years. And, she really owned that position. Well, after a while, it became clear that I needed to appoint a new directress. I visited with the directress who had told me she felt she needed to slow down a little and to begin the process of transition. I think she thought it might take longer than I did, but that's neither here nor there. But I assured her of her good works and her ministry and why I was doing this. And I think it worked out okay for her. It was hard for my dear friend Olive to step down, but she did. And I asked Martha to take over the new job, and she did it with fear and trembling. But she had new ideas, and she even recruited a bunch of new people to the altar guild, and we even started a junior altar guild. So, my friends, let's remember that we're not indispensable to God's church. We are an important part, not the only part, but working together to build up God's kingdom. Together, you all will continue to do great things for God in this community. I am honored to be here tonight, to be a part of this service, honored to share the thanks for these clergy who have served you all so well during this time. And as I said at the beginning, this is a great evening for this congregation, for the Lord, and for the Diocese of Fort Worth. Amen.